Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I'd like to welcome you all to today's Monday noon discussion at the Kennan Institute. Today's presentation is The Links Between Organized Crime and Terrorism in Eurasian Nuclear Smuggling. And we are very fortunate today to have with us Louise Shelly, Director of the Transnational Crime and Corruption Center at American University, and Robert Orttung, who's Associate Research Professor at TRAC at American University. This event today is co-sponsored by the Woodrow Wilson Center's Division of International Security Studies, and I'd like to thank their director, Robert Litvak, for his help in putting today's event together. This event is also being webcast on the Wilson Center's website and will be available for viewing, if you really like it, after you get back. It will be available on our website after today's event, and our website is www.wilsoncenter.org. My name is Joe Dresden. I'm Program Associate at the Kennan Institute. Just to say a word, the Kennan Institute's mission is to increase American understanding and expertise on the Russian Federation and surrounding states. I'd like to take a moment at this time to announce some upcoming events that we have for the rest of the calendar year. On Thursday, December 15th, we'll have Sergei Plokhi, the Professor of History at the University of Alberta, who will discuss Ukraine's quest for Europe, history, geography, and identity. And our final event for the calendar year will be Volodymyr Dubovik, who is director at the Center for International Studies and associate professor at the Department of International Relations of Odessa National University. He will be talking on Ukraine's foreign policy since the Orange Revolution. And I'll just quickly announce our first event in January. We will be co-sponsoring with the Africa Program a presentation entitled Crafting Peace, Strategies to Deal with Warlords in Collapsing States, Case Studies, Tajikistan and Sierra Leone. And the presenter will be Sasha Lezhnev, author and international program officer at the Northern Uganda Peace Initiative. And that event, of course, is co-sponsored by the Africa Program. That date, again, is Thursday, January 5, from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. And event details are on the Wilson Center website. Russia is facing an increasing threat of terrorism, including evidence that terrorist groups are interested in obtaining nuclear materials from Russian facilities. Today, Louise and Bob will examine the security situation around some of Russia's key nuclear storage facilities and link threats to them back to networks in the Caucasus and other parts of the world. In particular, they will examine the connections between terrorists and organized crime groups. And let me say a few words about our presenters. Louise, as I said, is the founder and director of TRAC at American University and a leading expert on organized crime and corruption in the former Soviet Union. Her expertise is in international crime and corruption, including money laundering, illicit financial flows, human smuggling, trafficking, national security issues, and use of information technology by international crime groups, and the linkages between organized crime and terrorism. Since 1995, she has run programs in Russia, Ukraine, and most recently Georgia with leading specialists on the problem of organized crime and corruption. And she's the author of Policing Soviet Policy, as well as numerous articles and book chapters. She's also a professor at American University's School of International Service, and had a fellowship at the Kennan Institute, as well as full fellowships from Fulbright, Guggenheim, and NEH. Bob Orttung is Research Associate Professor at TRAC at American University, and a visiting scholar at the Center for Security Studies at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich. He is the editor of Russian Regional Report, a biweekly newsletter that tracks political and economic developments in Russia's 89 regions. And if you come up to him, he can tell you how to subscribe to that. It's a long website, which I don't want to read here. He is the author, editor, or co-editor of a number of publications, including The Dynamics of Russian Politics, Putin's Reform of the Federal Regional Regions, and in two volumes, the Republican Regions of the Russian Federation, A Guide to Politics, Policies, and Leaders, and Russia's 1995 Parliamentary Elections, The Battle for the Duma, and finally, From Leningrad to St. Petersburg, Democratization in a Russian City. I should also note that Bob was a Title VIII short-term scholar as well. And I think we'll start today with Louise.
Thank you all for coming in this busy holiday season. We've structured our presentation that I'll start off with some of the international security issues that we've been working on. Then Bob is going to talk about the Chelyabinsk case study, and then I'll talk a bit more on the Caucasus. Our research most recently has been focusing on some of the reported incidents of serious nuclear smuggling, where we have tried to go into understanding the networks that are involved in this nuclear smuggling. So we're not dealing with just hypothetical cases. U.S. protection policies at the moment are based solely on technical solutions. That is, lock up the materials. But this is a very serious problem. As I say about it, it is brilliantly engineered but fatally flawed, as they do not address the crime and terrorism challenge. One of the things that we're discovering and the biggest challenges seem to be not the rogue scientists that individuals worried about a decade ago, but the problems of corruption and of crime groups. In discussions that we have had with some of the contractors who are doing work on protecting major WMD sites, we have learned that they are having serious problems with organized crime, because organized crime is involved in some of the same sectors in Russia that it is involved in the United States, that is, construction and transport. And we've even had contractors who've worked in this non-proliferation area tell us about individuals who have worked for them who have been murdered for refusing to cooperate with organized crime. But after the murder, the project went on. So that tells you that there is a problem. But in all of our planning and strategic thinking in this area, we're not focusing on doing crime analysis. We're not focusing on doing terror analysis. We're looking at dealing with locking up facilities and depending on the state. And the problem that we're dealing with, as we've looked at in the post-9/11 world, is what are we dealing with non-state actors? And that's the security challenge that we're not thinking about. And I'll say that we're not the only ones thinking about it. GAO at the present time is doing an analysis of some of our protection programs and is focusing on the issue of how we are paying inadequate attention to the corruption, the crime, and the terrorism issues that may be undermining major elements of our protection of weapons of mass destruction. So locking up the materials is certainly not sufficient, and corruption can undermine the best of technical security. And as we know, the region that we love and frequent, Bob and I, is one riddled with corruption. And Bob has a very fine piece coming out in World Politics shortly on the geography of corruption in Russia. So at present, there is not a consistent analysis of this crime and terror challenge to nuclear materials, either in the U.S. or in projects financed by the U.S. government. And it needs to be there. And needs to be especially in the port area and in many of the transit routes. Why is this such a particular challenge? Because there is a market for these materials. We're not talking about stealing, and maybe we are, but that's not what we're talking about in our research and what the identified cases have been of stolen nuclear materials, but there is a market for small amounts of the materials. And different groups are seeking these, not necessarily the actors that you may always be thinking about, but there are others that are interested in these nuclear materials. And even though the sort of small samples that are out there, or those are the ones that have been detected and apprehended, are significant if you get into the mind of a terrorist, because even a small amount of material can have a demonstration effect. It is because part of what we look at in terrorism is the escalating impact. And this is very important, is the demonstration effect of it. One of the things that Bob will talk about in looking at the Chelyabinsk case study, an area that has been problematic already, is the diversity of groups that are involved with smuggling of all kinds. And what seems to be from our research is that this smuggling that the nuclear materials have, the routes that they have taken, have not been any different from the other smuggling routes that we have been looking at for other commodities. And that's because organized crime controls these transport links, just as the the longest and most criminalized union in the United States is the Teamsters Union. This is a very serious challenge in Russia as well, where the level of criminalization of the economy is very significant. And one of the problems that we need to be focusing much more on is the links that are being formed by post-Soviet criminals imprisoned with terrorists in European prisons. When people say, well, how does one know that there's information out there? There needs to be much more understanding of what is going on in prisons. And many, many years ago, there was a wonderful expert on organized crime, the head of the Pennsylvania Organized Crime Commission, who was a little too good at his work. He managed to get the governor of the state of Pennsylvania locked up for his involvement with organized crime. But the governor managed to close up the Pennsylvania Organized Crime Commission before this happened. But one of his major sources of information on which he analyzed all of this was understanding the logistical planning that goes on in prisons. And until we begin to understand this, we're not going to understand a lot of what is going on. And these crime terror ties are of business interests. There was an article a week ago in U.S. News and World Report which talked about terrorists turning to crime as a way of financing their activities. But as we're going to be talking about in the rest of this presentation, these links are much, much more complex. And they are not just financial links. They're logistical links. I mean, yesterday, if you were reading the New York Times and thinking about the case of the Iraqi antiquities that have been stolen and the prosecutor who's just written a book on this is that they're in the hands of terrorists, but they weren't some of the stolen antiquities, but they weren't originally stolen by terrorists. And it's this kind of logistical links where some group steals it and transfers it to others, which is a crucial part of the situation that is not being addressed by people sufficiently. And even though this adage goes that criminals are engaged in crime for profit and terrorists are there for political motivations, the situation is a little bit more complicated than that, and certainly affects the issue that we're studying, because often criminals do have a political sense. They may not be nationalistic like the mafia that won't do this, that have a loyalty to the state, but they may have shared enemies that they share with the terrorists, and therefore they're motivated by a shared enemy perspective. So we have nuclear smuggling that is not necessarily motivated solely by a profit motive. The criminals that are involved in this may be doing it for money, but there may be some other things on their agenda as well, because there are people that threaten them, that have persecuted them, and they may share common goals with terrorists. So we're looking at often an intersection of crime and terrorists where two kinds of actors are working together. And the particular nexus is in the area of logistics, transport, and couriers. Let me turn it over to Bob.
What I want to describe here is a little more in detail some of the research we've done that fleshes out the kind of argument that Louise has been making in general terms, and which is to look at in much more nuance the connections between the organized crime groups and the terror groups. And we've done a big research project in Chelyabinsk over the last year, and this diagram lays out many of the basic findings that we found there. And if you look at it looking from left to right, the basic idea is that inside the circle is a closed city in the region of Chelyabinsk. Ozersk, where there's a major nuclear facility. And then as you move toward the right, in the square, is a terrorist group. And what we're trying to show here is the different threats inside the closed city and possibilities for moving the material from the closed city to the terrorist group if it should want it. And just to give you a few details on what's here, we did a lot of interviews and research with people in Chelyabinsk Oblast who are familiar with the situation inside the closed city and who are also familiar with the local crime scene and the situation on the border. Chelyabinsk is right on the Kazakhstan border. And so what we found was right near the city of Ozersk is a lot of Tartar and Bashkir communities just outside of the closed city. And those communities, most of them are obviously honest, decent people, but they're the target of extremist recruiters, groups that come in looking, extremist groups, Wahhabi groups, that are identified by the Russian FSB as looking for terrorist recruits in that area. And those people are often brought into the closed city because inside the closed city itself, there's a shortage of blue-collar workers. And so there's a potential connection, as you see on the top line, transecting from outside the city into the city. And so we thought that those people potentially could have access to some of the nuclear materials. Another source that might have access to the nuclear materials are corrupt officials working within MIAC. There's been several instances where those officials have been involved with different companies. And so that could be another source of leakage from the materials. A third possibility is students working and selling drugs, working inside the closed city where many of them live, bringing drugs in. And then those people are obviously connected back to typically Tajik drug groups that bring the drugs from Afghanistan into Russia. It's been a problem since the late 1990s in Russia, and there's been little effective policy against drug use in Russia. So the problem seems to be increasing over time. Putin set up, of course, in 2003 a major agency to deal with the drug problem, but it seems to be extremely ineffective in carrying out any real improvement. And the last potential source where we might see problems inside the closed city is an increased number of released convicts, who are people who had been in prison in Russian jails. And now, and these are people who had formerly lived inside the closed city, committed a crime, and then were sent to jail. In the Soviet days, they were not allowed to come back into the closed city, but they are allowed to come back now as a humanitarian measure, because many of their families are in the closed city, and they would have difficulty supporting themselves if they were forced to live outside the closed city. But as Louise mentioned, the prisons in Russia, as anywhere else in the world, are a very useful meeting place for people from different networks. So the organized crime networks might meet up with people who are coming from terrorist networks inside the Russian prison. And that could link people inside the city, inside the closed city, back to the terrorist group. And then as you move to the right across the border of the closed city, we're looking for potential ways of transporting, assuming the material is taken outside of the facility, how would you move it? So we looked at three possibilities. One is that there's a very criminalized taxi service in the closed city, and there's often razborki, which is sort of gangland fights between the two different taxi services working in the city. So it suggests that there's a heavy criminal element throughout that whole industry. And that could potentially serve as a way of transporting materials. We're talking about very small amounts of material that could easily be moved inside of a single car. A second problem is the conscript soldiers who are standing on the border of the city. Many of them are just young men coming from all over Russia, 18 to 20 years old, who are very hungry, very bored, have nothing to do. It's very easy for recruiters to pick them off one by one and use them as links between the city. And third is the construction industry, which in Chelyabinsk, as everywhere else in the world, is also heavily corrupt. And so there's lots of links inside the city and outside the city. And of course, this is all taking place within the broader framework of, the typical crime and corruption that you see in Russia. So it's very easy, for example, to come into the city. It's only necessary if you have the right connections to pay a bribe of even as small as $5 to some of the conscript soldiers who are standing on the border. And we should also point out that in the 1990s, the closed city was a special economic zone, which in the Russian case, as in other cases around the world, this is a place where there's people bring and register their businesses for specific tax benefits that you don't have to. If you're working in this area, you don't have to pay taxes to the federal government or to the regional government. So it was in the interest of many companies to come to this area and register. And so by setting up a special economic zone, it's a red flag for people who are looking at crime issues, because that brings in a lot of people, of course, who have legitimate business interests, but a lot of people have illegitimate business interests and who are simply seeking a way to avoid taxes or to launder criminal money. So when you have a special economic zone like existed here in the late 90s and into the beginning of this decade, it creates a lot of networks through that link it back to a wide variety of criminal groups. And this is relevant, again, because in the March 2005 elections, the voters in the city of Ozersk brought back the same mayor who had run these special economic zone and who had built up this elaborate network of connections, some of them legitimate, some of them illegitimate. And so it's potential that while the zone is no longer there, the connections that were built are still there. So the whole city is in a sense operating in a very criminalized and corrupt atmosphere. And then finally, just moving toward the terrorist group, we looked at four potential actors that could transport the material. As Louise mentioned, and she's going to talk a little bit further in the second part of her presentation, much of the material that is found has been found in the Caucasus area, in Georgia in particular, and carried by Caucasian carriers. And so we were looking at potential sources that could bring the material from Chelyabinsk to a place like that. And that could be anything from transnational actors. We did a study of the Chelyabinsk airport, for example, and there was a huge smuggling ring that was bringing automobile parts in and from Germany, which could easily be used to transport stuff out. There's a huge drug trade in Chelyabinsk. It's right on the border with Kazakhstan, and one of the main flow points for drugs coming up from Afghanistan, many of them going on to Western Siberia, where there's lots of money from the oil, and then on to Western Europe. There's an increasing number of customs brokers, which is a phenomenon all along the Russian border, which is a way of institutionalizing corruption in the sense that in the past, for example, if a business wanted to move goods across the border, it would have to find a corrupt border guard to pay off. Now it's not necessary to find that corrupt guard. It's possible to go to a customs broker who can arrange for all the movement of goods across the border. And it's not clear, while on one hand a company can sign a formal agreement with the customs broker, it's not clear exactly what the customs broker then does, if it just arranges the bribes that are necessary to move the goods across the border or simply takes care of all the paperwork. And then there's an Azeri metal trade network. Scrap metal is obviously a big profitable industry in Russia, and it would be very easy to use the existing networks that are set up to move the scrap metal from Russia outside into Iran and to other countries to move nuclear material as well. And so the terrorist group could use all these different connections. And then as you see across the top and you know, back through the prisons or through new mosques which are being set up in Chelyabinsk with Arab funding, it's the terrorist group could potentially use any bit or piece of this organized crime network for its own purposes. So the argument here is not really that there's one single organized crime group that specializes in smuggling nuclear materials, but that there's a vast array of networks dealing with drugs, fruit, all kinds of contraband goods that are being brought into Russia legally or illegally, and that the terrorist group could use any one of these to get access to the material and then to transport that material where it wanted to go. But let me turn it back over to Louise, who will finish looking at the Caucasus.
What we know from these cases that have been detected is that the nuclear materials are moving long distances before they are detected. We're talking about thousands of miles. And there's several possibilities of why these are being detected in the Caucasus. One is that the detection equipment has been placed there. That secondly, there's since the Rose Revolution, there's been an effort to clean up law enforcement, and the equipment is not being turned off as it had been in the past. And also that, you know, it's on this route that it's being detected. We don't know on some of the other routes, you know, if there are other routes. But this route makes a lot of sense for several reasons. First of all, if you think about the crime that existed at the close of the Soviet Union, and you think about the thieves in law, this traditional organized crime, much of it was based in the Caucasus. So that there has, and it's these groups that have moved a lot into the transport sector, and they've also been globalized. They are operating in Europe, they are operating elsewhere in the world, and therefore you're looking at a network structure that is very hard to detect. And the individuals who are actually moving the materials are the couriers, just as you would find in a drug organization. The operation is set up. It's not something that is random, because the individual who the material has been passed off to is not somebody who has traversed the distances all the way from the nuclear facility from where this material originated to the distance where the people at the border have picked them up. And there also seems to be a cooperation among ethnic groups, because crime territory is controlled by one group, yet passages going across regions with members of other ethnic groups. And this is something that you find with organized crime. You have groups that cooperate in crime that may not cooperate elsewhere. And by segmenting the operation, you are making it very difficult to detect the whole crime network. The destination and the quantity of the materials suggests that it is being planned of usage for dirty bombs rather than a purchase by a rogue state, at least in the cases that have been detected, because you're looking at a route that is going from central parts of Russia through to the Caucasus and out towards a western destination. It could possibly be moved there from elsewhere, but since the border, as was just mentioned by Bob, between Russia and Kazakhstan is extremely long, is not very well guarded, and the possibilities of enormous smuggling, of moving things along with drug shipments or other activities, suggests that the fact that these materials are being moved in this direction suggests that there is an important sort of mechanism that it's at work. It's not a random problem. It has been repeated, and it's not as if, you know, the problem has stopped. So one is looking at a smuggling pattern where there seems to be planning that is going from the point of which the material is acquired to an area of where it is exiting from the space of the former Soviet Union. The materials that have been found have not been found on the basis of intelligence, but on the basis of radiation detectors, which is one of the things that raises concern, because one, you know, how is this happening without people being aware of it? Secondly, you don't have radiation detectors everywhere, which suggests that you're not getting everything. Just like on the U.S.-Mexican border, you know, our whole border is not totally guarded or protected. And in this region, you've got extremely porous borders, enormous corruption. In some of our earlier research that you can find on the web and that we're producing in a book that we're doing on Georgia, you've got enormous smuggling networks that go through Abkhazia, that go through South Ossetia, that used to go through Ajara. So it is highly unlikely that 100% of this material is being detected. And there is little understanding of the actors involved or the target destinations of these materials. And one of the things that we, as people who study crime, are trying to understand, because there are certain sort of signature patterns of this smuggling networks, is how they fit in to our general understanding of these issues, because this material is not so extensive, and as Bob has said, that we are looking at a special nuclear smuggling network. So part of the reason that this may be coming through to the Caucasus, apart from the very well-established crime groups, is the presence of separatist regions where there is no effective controls by military or law enforcement. It is a total smuggler's paradise. We're not precluding that some of this may be moved by trains. We've often joked that some of it could be arriving by the same way that you smuggle sturgeon. You could smuggle nuclear materials because the wheels are greased for the smuggling of fish and caviar. And so once you've neutralized the effective control of the state, you can use it for other commodities as well. But there also seems to be a role of some of these conflict zones that are outside the control of central state authority. And while many people poo-poo the presence of these thieves in law as an old form of organized crime, they are not the archaic structures that they were. They are network structures that are now internationalized, so that not only have we found representative of these thieves in law working near the facilities in Chelyabinsk where materials have gone missing, as well as they've been found in Spain and Belgium and elsewhere in the world. So these linkages are very real. And while we've seen the collapse of the Soviet Union, we have long-standing cooperation among the post-Soviet crime networks. And that also seems to be what is going on, is that we have these multi-ethnic smuggling networks. This problem, when someone says, well, where is this, you know, crime-terror nexus going, is that part of the problem of finding or saying, how do you link up with a terrorist, is that often criminals do not know who a terrorist is. Because terrorists these days are working often with forged passports, fraudulent documents, and are operating as petty criminals. And therefore, they're sitting in prisons as petty criminals. They may be disguising their activities so that a criminal does not know they're linking up with a terrorist. There's only one case I know where this was told to me by the deputy prosecutor of Palermo, is that they found that there was a crime link between an Albanian terrorist group and the mafia. But the mafia thought they were working with just a group of Albanian organized crime. So when they explained to the mafia who their partners were, they broke up this relationship. This is not what goes on with post-Soviet organized crime. One, if you told them that they're working with a bunch of terrorists, they might say, you know, that person's terrorist is a freedom fighter for us. There is also not this sense of responsibility to the state, these sort of split identities that you find between a guerrilla, a terrorist, a freedom fighter in the separatist zones makes these distinctions all very blurred. And with some of these couriers that have been discovered, sometimes they know what they're moving, sometimes they don't. But in such a case of poverty, where the family is more important than the state, individuals are willing to do things even if they believe it has a great risk to themselves because they can save families by doing something with significant profit. And one of the consequences that we've had of the Rose Revolution is that you've had many, many senior personnel who are on the job, who may have been corrupt but had experience, but now you've got many inexperienced people. And so it takes a certain feel for your subject matter to sometimes know what you need to pick up and to detect things. And that is not something that is going on in Georgia today. And on some of the other border areas, you're finding enormous corruption of customs and border officials. So it is very hard to detect this illicit activity in such a large shadow economy, because the kinds of materials that are being found are small. We're not talking about large-scale shipments, but something that can be moved along with something else. And it's in this large illicit economy. Georgia's illicit economy is 70%, according to a latest analysis in a publication. So that you're not looking at something in which you have clearly defined commodities that you can say, oh, this is something that is being moved along. So this is our major conclusions, is that this crime problem is not a hypothetical problem. Criminals are actually moving nuclear materials, and that there is a market by terrorists for this, and what we have yet to explore, or we are exploring and yet to fully establish, is how these linkages are being made. But the consequence and the overall conclusion of this is that this crime and terror situation is not just a financial one. It is a logistical one. It is a much more complex relationship than we've understood to the present, and needs much more attention that doesn't just focus on technical solutions. Because I hope that the radiation detectors have found all of this. But without intelligence and without fully policed borders, it's not clear that all of this stuff that is moving from secure facilities has actually been stopped and found. And we need to be providing a crime and terror analysis that understands much more the regions of vulnerability and integrate this much more into our threat analysis and our policies of how we safeguard weapons of mass destruction. Thank you.
Thank you, Louise. We have about 20 minutes for discussion. I'm going to ask the first question, prerogative of the chair. And I just want to ask if you could provide some examples of smuggling operations that have been caught, and if you could maybe talk about some of the materials that were found, and maybe if you know what those materials could possibly do in the wrong hands, you know, what kind of and also if they're able to track any of these materials back to their site of origin based on the content, the chemical composition, what have you.
All right. The cases that we're working from now are highly enriched uranium in small quantities. The material has been able to be traced back. That's why I was talking. I won't say where it's been traced back to, but that it's thousands of miles away from where it's detected.
Right. Okay. All right, let's go to the floor, please. First question in the middle aisle here. Please identify yourself, and please restrain yourself to one question or one comment so that we can get to everybody. Thank you.
David Mosier from RAND. Enjoyed your presentation. I had a question. You started up by saying that our policies aren't complete, that we aren't really doing the right thing. It's highly technical but fatally flawed. You talked a lot about some trafficking problems, et cetera, but what about our policy is actually flawed? I mean, if you want to stop stuff from getting into people's hands, you do want to lock it up. You do want to make sure that they can't get to it. You do want to have the sorts of controls that our programs are aiming towards, whether they're successful or not. Is varied depending on the city and the facility. But what would you do differently? What should the U.S. do differently than it's doing today to make it less fatally flawed, if you will?
Well, that's another hour's talk, at least. It's probably a several hours talk. But the first example that I gave you of the contractor that is having problems with organized crime, and there is no vetting of subcontractors. There's no requirement under DOD requirements to people working on weapons of mass destruction site that they are understanding the crime component of who are the actors that are intruding onto their sites, just as nothing is going on in some of the protections in these facilities of what is the, you know, the workers that are being brought in to do this. That's one of the first things. People are not, this issue is not a peripheral issue. And there, I mean, I think the Adamov case, in which you had corruption very high up in the Ministry of Atomic Energy, and you had, you know, diversion of foreign aid. This is an issue that needs much more central attention, which we're not looking at until we're absolutely confronted in the face about it.
I think the basic point is that there's a lot of money going into building fences and putting in cameras and things like that, but there's not a lot of interest in looking at who's actually operating this stuff, who's actually building this stuff. The U.S. is trying to create a culture of subcontractors in Russia so that this work can be contracted out to outside firms outside the nuclear facility. There's not a lot of attention to be paying to who those firms are, what their connections are, perhaps into the drug world. And so that's the major area where we need to make some changes.
And I should say that a lot of these facilities are along the drug route. And so, Bob could have been a little more specific on some of the findings, but there's actually been cases found of drug abuse within the staff of the nuclear facilities. We're not looking at this impact of this absolutely rapidly growing drug problem and the drug routes and the vulnerabilities of the people that are working there. I mean, they're just numerous things that when you start looking at the crime issue, the transport, the subcontractors, the vulnerability of how you could introduce, has been introduced drugs into these facilities. We were asked to host a conference under one of our other projects on drug use in Mayak because the Russians thought this is such a serious problem that they wanted to bring attention to it.
Okay. We have a lot of questions on the floor. Please, right here on the side. Please use the microphone.
Tom Hirschfeld, CNA. You did mention that there were small, what you're dealing with primarily are small quantities of highly enriched uranium moving considerable distances. What you didn't mention, or I didn't hear you mention, were ultimate destination. Who's buying these things?
That's the $64,000 or more than that question, which is something we're trying to understand more of now.
Okay. Okay. In the back, in the green shirt, please.
Sonia Benwagram from the Monterey Institute. Louise, you mentioned that some post-Soviet criminals were in prison with terrorists. Do you have any in Europe? Do you have any examples that you could quote here, specific examples?
No, I do have examples, but I'm not going to quote them here.
Okay. And right next.
Hi, Laura Holgate from the Nuclear Threat Initiative. Just a comment. I'll urge you to be real careful about your use of the word dirty bomb. If you're talking about detection of highly enriched uranium, that's not an input for a dirty bomb. That's an input for an actual improvised nuclear device of a Hiroshima-type potential. And while that may be aimed at terrorists and not state actors, I think that's an important distinction. But don't confuse dirty bombs and INDs. It's also important to know that highly enriched uranium isn't readily detected by radiation detectors, and so it's easily shielded, so that's another interesting thing. But I'll ask you the question that I'm asked all the time. If these networks that you've presented in such chilling specificity are as capable as they seem to be, why haven't we seen more smuggling of high, you know, bomb-relevant quantities as opposed to gram quantities of highly enriched uranium? What's your explanation? Are we just not seeing it, or is it? Are they just sitting on it?
It's hard to say. Probably we're not seeing it. But what we were looking at here is just trying to get a sense of the vulnerabilities at these plants, and you know where could it come from. Obviously, you know, there's a list the IAEA has of the known cases. We don't have any more than that. What we were looking at was trying to figure out. If the terrorists wanted to steal this kind of stuff, how could they use organized crime and corruption? And so obviously you look at Russia, you know, from the outside, and I think a lot of people from the inside who we've been working with, criminologists and those kind of people, see this massive sea of crime, these networks of crime groups, And so it's impossible to imagine that inside all that corruption and organized crime that there's islands of stability where the crime groups wouldn't reach. And so there's increasing, you know, as the Chechen war drags on, as there's more violence across, not just in Chechnya, but across the entire Caucasus, as the level of terrorist attack in Russia increases, it's only logical to think that they're going to try and use some of this material against a facility or against infrastructure in Russia. And so therefore, you know, people in Russia who focus on crime issues and people like us who've been focusing on organized crime for a while are trying to figure out how those crime networks could be used to grab this material. So that's really what we're trying to get at here. And we're not saying that, you know, it's going to be a big flood of this stuff out of the facilities, but there are things that need to be looked at in a lot more detail to ensure that that doesn't happen.
I'll also say that there has been smuggling of other materials other than this, other than these cases of reported uranium materials, but those we've been able to understand more about the roots because of the source and the actors.
Okay. In the front row, the blazer, please.
Thank you. Hi, Bill Hain with RANSAC. I'm curious whether you've briefed any of this research at all with Russian officials and what their reaction may have been, whether it's been amazement or indifference or hostility. Are they revoking your visas, that sort of thing? Or if not, you know, what are your plans to discuss this with the Russian side? So it seems to me at the end of the day, the burden isn't really on the United States to come up with solutions and figure out answers to all of these problems that you've identified. But really the burden is going to be on Russia at the end of the day to come up with the solutions. And so I'm just curious what your plans are and what some of the discussions you've had have been. Thanks.
Well, been talking to lots of different people, not really the official people who are charged with protecting the nuclear sites or with the FSB, but we mostly talk with our fellow academics and other people who are studying crime and corruption, people at the MVD Academy and places like that. And they're seeing the exact same problems that we are. You know, they're very deeply concerned about the drug networking and the movement of metals throughout Russia. And so those kind of people are deeply concerned. But, you know, we don't have access to the people who guard the facilities. You know, we did our research not in contact with those people, but in contact with other people who have less official positions.
Well, let me just say that about the beginning of September, some of the components of this research were presented at an international forum. And in attendance was one Russian who works on terrorism issues, who is not an academic, who just happened after this session to get into an extensive discussion with me on nuclear smuggling, because we had the component pieces on it, the corruption in the military, some of what is going on with the ethnic groups and the fundamentalist recruitment and the drug routes. And this person, who is a specialist on terrorism, especially Chechen terrorism, was extremely concerned and said that there's concern you know, on the Russian side of this. And our research previously on the geography of crime, we know, was used because the person who used to head our Moscow center was the person who was the input on classifying the strategy, the most strategic targets in Russia and what was the priority that was given to them. So we're not having a direct discussion, but we know that there's input.
Okay, right down here.
Will Amatruda, Catholic University Law School. To what extent do the crime networks you've talked about have their roots in the Soviet period, and to what extent have they sprung up like mushrooms after the breakup of the Soviet Union? Have you come to any conclusions on that question?
There's a whole variety of this. Some of what we're looking at of organized crime and the corruption and in the transport section and construction sector seem to be some of the old-fashioned organized crime. Some of the organized crime that seems to be most linked with terrorism is what has come out of the separatist regions the civil conflict, the new forms of organized crime that have emerged post-collapse of the Soviet Union with this enormous regional violence that has occurred and guerrilla movements. What is particularly new, and that's what I'd like Bob to say a little bit more, is the rise of varieties of potential terrorist groups that are operating within Russia. And that's what's so different as well.
Well, that's a really difficult question to do research on. And so, you know, obviously we tried to make contacts with the authorities in Russia who deal with this kind of stuff, but they haven't been very responsive. But I think that what you can get, you know, as working in open sources is that occasionally the FSB in Russia puts out information because they want to show to their public that they're doing their job, that they're arresting terrorists. And so occasionally you do get information of, you know, we arrested some people from, say, the Grey Wolves, and Chelyabinsk seemed to be interested in the nuclear facilities, or some Wahhabi groups. It's not clear which ones or how it relates back to Chechnya, for example. But so there's occasional releases of information like that, and then so if you track all that, you can try and put together a sense of which groups are operating there and what they seem to be going after. But again, it's very difficult, and we just have bits and pieces of anecdotal information, nothing, not a clear picture at all of what's going on.
Yes, the two in that row, please. We'll take them in order.
James Duran, Atlantic Council. We have the Adamov case, which is corruption at the highest level of the government in this field of related to nuclear energy. Is this a simple case of taking kickbacks from subcontractors and contractors? It opens the way to blackmail. It opens the way to a lot of serious problems and implications at the highest levels, and the appointment of Kiryenko is an indication that it is taken extremely seriously at the very center of power. I would like your comment on the case, the nature of what we're hearing, and its implications.
I would say that Russians who have knowledge about this case have commented to me that it's a very serious case, that it's more than just, you know, diversion of funds or bribery. And when you said about this appointment of Kiryenko, the problem is that I don't think they know the extent of the damage caused by this, but it is certainly raising extreme concerns within people who are following the terrorism issue within Russia.
Mm-hmm. Just working in Chelyabinsk, I know there are a lot of people there who are very angry that from their point of view, a lot of the corruption locally is pushed down on them from Moscow. So, you know, people at the top are working down, so that corruption from Moscow feeds into to the regional level and creates more corruption on there. So it's got to be having a very negative effect.
Okay. John, right there.
John Young from the American Council for the UN University Millennium Project. Considering the easy availability, even in from non-nuclear areas like medicine and industry, of the required materials, why do you think it is that we've been lucky enough to avoid any actual dirty bomb incidents so far?
I'm hopeful, but I think that sometimes in some of the, if you look at the time it takes to develop a successful terrorist plot, you're sometimes talking about several years. And so some of this materials that we're looking at have been moved rather recently, and the problem is that this has to be, it can be retained for quite a, its shelf life, unfortunately, is quite long. And the technical capacity to use it is not the easiest in the world. But also, if you're looking at the dynamics and trajectory of terrorism and needing an escalating threat, it's something that, you know, we may be moving towards, but we're not there yet.
Right. I mean, certainly along, if you look at the way things have been evolving in the Caucasus, the most recent attack on Nalchik, obviously it wasn't very effective, but clearly they were going after key installations, the police, the local security agencies, the airport. So they're becoming a little more sophisticated. They're not attacking schools anymore. They're focusing in on things that they think might really hurt the Russian state. And so if you follow the trajectory of that logic, then it would seem logical that this would be something that they would think about in the future.
Any more questions from the floor? Do you have another one? Please wait for the microphone so that you can be heard.
Dave Mosier from RAND again. We've done analysis looking at the threats to the United States and others from materials being taken from Russia. And we focus on the weapon side, not on the dirty bomb side. So we're looking at sort of more, we're looking for more significant quantities, I guess, not to use the words properly, but you know what I mean. One of the things that we kept foundering on was this question of why haven't we seen more of this? If the demand is out there, and there are clearly a few groups, not many, and I caution you about using the word terrorist group and then assuming that they want WMD or using it, that they would use it, because in the history of terrorist groups, there are very, very few who have shown any interest in WMD, particularly nuclear. That could change, but what I'm saying is they aren't synonymous. But one of the things we found was that these groups weren't, that the terrorist groups, you know, we couldn't find where the market mechanism would meet. You had people who had lots of supply. You had people who certainly were willing to pay some big money for this, as Al-Qaeda had demonstrated. And yet we couldn't find the connections to be made. And we pondered this question, and we looked at the organized crime question, why weren't they more involved? And one of one of the hypotheses we had was that in the organized crime business, you're basically, it's a business. You're trying to make money, and you alluded to this a little bit. But you're making money, you know, it's illegal, but you're trying to maximize your profit. You're trying to make business. And what you're not trying to do is get away with, you know, a one-shot deal is not always in your interest. And so the question I have to you, and I see you shaking your head, and you're thinking about sort of, I'm thinking organized crime, maybe bigger groups. You've been talking about sort of smaller crime groups, and maybe that's where our perspectives differ. But again, those smaller crime groups, do they have the connections that the organized crime does to transmit it? I'd just like you to comment on that a little bit, if you could talk about it in some detail.
There's clearly, how would I say, many people, there are a lot of problems in that analysis. First of all, these crime groups are not hierarchical crime groups. I have a piece that is in the Brown Journal of International Affairs where I look at this relationship between crime groups that are involved with terrorists and those that are not. And it's on our website. There's a lot of material you'd find of use on our website. But to say that, you know, you're talking about big groups, you're not going to be finding major drug trafficking organizations involved in this. But you're going to be finding crime like terrorism is extremely focused on networks. And these networks are sufficiently connected often. I mean, if you look at the case of the bombing in Madrid in 3/11 March, you were looking at something that was planned in prison, where you had networks of criminals working with networks of terrorists. And there was some recruitment, but that there was also logistical support. And you're thinking too conventionally about the way crime works, the way their motive structure works, to understand what is actually going on in these relationships today by people who are actually going out and doing this undercover work and looking at this.
Okay. We've reached the end of the hour, and I'd like to give Louise and Bob one final opportunity to announce where you can find more details on their work and on their center. So please, Louise, if you have any forthcoming reports coming out or anything else you want to plug, please do so now.
Plug our website. Oh, we have a book coming out on Georgia, and we have a book coming out. We have a book series with Routledge.
Okay, and you want to give your website address, please?
www.american.edu/track. And we have brochures out at the front desk.
All right. Please join me in thanking Louise Shelly and Bob Orttung for the presentation today. And thanks again to the Division of International Security Studies.
Hi.
Hi. Sure, we'll be very happy. Sure, anytime this week, next week, or after the new year. Yeah. I'm leaving town later on this week, but next week. Okay, early part of the week.